Dear colleagues, I will present a case of a woman with hypertension with the purpose to show the usual evaluation and treatment in such cases. The ECG, the echocardiogram, the echocardiographic assessment of diastolic function and the treatment will be discussed. The patient is a woman 53 years old, smoker, with a history of hypertension on treatment with irbesartan 150 mg per day. On presentation, systolic blood pressure was 170 and diastolic blood pressure was 100 millimeters mercury. This is stage 2 hypertension, since the systolic blood pressure is over 160 and the diastolic is 100. You can see here the classification of hypertension by the World Health Organization and the European Society of Cardiology. The patient's ECG shows sinus rhythm and normal frontal and the normal frontal QRS axis, since the net QRS forces are positive in leads 1 and 2. The frontal QRS axis is normal. A striking feature is the diffuse T-wave inversion in many leads. There is a deep T-wave inversion in leads V3 to V6 with a downsloping ST segment in leads V4 to V6. The cause of T-wave inversion could be left ventricular hypertrophy or coronary artery disease. In this case, the taller waves in leads V4, V5 and V6 and the downsloping ST segment in these leads suggest left ventricular hypertrophy as the most probable cause. The sum of the R wave in V5 and the S wave in V1 is over 35 mm, a positive Sokolov index, a feature also suggestive of left ventricular hypertrophy. Ischemic T-waves are usually symmetric, but in left ventricular hypertrophy, T-waves are usually asymmetric as in this ECG. But these rules can have exceptions. So this abnormal ECG probably represents left ventricular hypertrophy, but it might also represent ischemic T-wave inversion due to coronary artery disease. Left ventricular hypertrophy is an important risk factor. ECG evidence of left ventricular hypertrophy is associated with about threefold increase in cardiovascular events. So ECG evidence of left ventricular hypertrophy is associated with about threefold increase in cardiovascular events. Now let's see the patient's echocardiogram. The left parasternal long axis view shows increased thickness of the left ventricular walls, with normal left ventricular dimensions, so there is concentric hypertrophy of the left ventricle. Contractile function is good. In this view we can see the anterior septum and the posterior wall of the left ventricle, which are both thickened. Normal left ventricular wall thickness at end diastole is about 6 to 11 millimeters. In this case, left ventricular wall thickness was about 13 millimeters. The left atrium is also mildly dilated. Left atrial enlargement is also a finding often observed in hypertensive heart disease, and it is due to diastolic dysfunction. The left atrium is enlarged if its anteroposterior diameter is over 4 centimeters, or if its volume measured from the apical four-chamber view is over 34 milliliters per square meter of body surface area. The short axis left parasternal view at the mid-ventricular level also shows left ventricular hypertrophy and a good contractile function. Left ventricular hypertrophy in hypertension is a manifestation of target organ damage and also a risk factor associated with an increased risk of heart failure, stroke, myocardial infarction and death in patients with hypertension. For example, in patients with stage 1 hypertension, that is systolic blood pressure 140 to 159 and or diastolic blood pressure 90 to 99, the detection of left ventricular hypertrophy in stage 1 hypertension indicates the need for antihypertensive drug therapy earlier than it might have been if the patient did not have left ventricular hypertrophy or any other indication of target organ damage. Left ventricular hypertrophy also causes an impairment of left ventricular diastolic function. Patients with left ventricular hypertrophy, and also many patients with hypertension but without left ventricular hypertrophy, often have diastolic dysfunction. Severe diastolic dysfunction can cause effort dyspnea or even pulmonary edema in patients with normal ejection fraction. Let's emphasize that we should never use risk factors to scare patients. Risk factors only indicate an increased risk in comparison to the general population. Increased risk does not mean that a given patient inevitably will have a cardiovascular event. Risk factors for future adverse cardiovascular events such as left ventricular hypertrophy, hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, increased carotid artery intima media thickness 0.9 mm or more, renal dysfunction should be viewed as indications for more intensive treatment. Achieving the target goals for blood pressure and cholesterol will decrease the patient's risk for future cardiovascular events. The apical four chamber view shows the hypertrophic walls of the left ventricle. In this view, one can see the interventricular septum or posterior septum and the lateral wall. The view shown here is suboptimal since the left ventricle is foreshortened and so we cannot visualize the true apex. But we can see that the left ventricle has a good contractile function and we can clearly discern that the left atrium is dilated. Besides left ventricular hypertrophy, left atrial enlargement is also a common feature of hypertensive heart disease. Left atrial enlargement is also a common finding in mitral valve disease, but in this case the mitral valve was normal. Transmitral flow pulse wave Doppler is consistent with mild grade 1 diastolic dysfunction of the delayed relaxation type, since the E wave of early diastolic transmitral flow is smaller than the end diastolic A wave, which corresponds to atrial systole, and the deceleration time of the E wave is increased over 200 milliseconds. The deceleration time is the time from the peak of the E wave to its end at the point it reaches the baseline. The tissue Doppler measurement of the velocity of motion of the septal or lateral mitral annulus is also an index of systolic and diastolic function. The mitral annulus moves towards the heart apex in systole and towards the base in diastole. There is a positive systolic wave, S wave, a negative early diastolic wave, the mitral annular E wave, and a negative end diastolic wave, the mitral annular A wave, which corresponds to the phase of atrial contraction when there is sinus rhythm. Generally, a reduced velocity of the mitral annulus E wave indicates diastolic dysfunction. Here the E wave of the mitral annulus has a peak velocity of 6.7 cm per second, which is moderately reduced, a finding consistent with a moderate degree of diastolic dysfunction. Normally, at the septal mitral annulus, the peak early diastolic E velocity should be over 8 cm per second, and in the lateral annulus at least 10 cm per second. Generally, a mitral annular E velocity of 5 cm per second or less is an indication of severe diastolic dysfunction and it also indicates a worse prognosis. In this case, the mitral flow E velocity is 67 cm per second. The corresponding velocity EA of the septal mitral annulus is 6.7 cm per second, and so the ratio of the E-wave velocity of mitral flow divided by the EA early diastolic velocity of the mitral annulus is 10. This value for the septal mitral annulus is considered borderline and does not allow a prediction about the presence or absence of an elevated left ventricular diastolic pressure. When this ratio E to EA at the septal annulus is over 15 or at the lateral annulus over 10, then it is usually indicative of an elevated left ventricular diastolic pressure and an elevated mean pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Another interesting observation is that although this patient has a normal ejection fraction, and we have already seen that the left ventricular walls have a good contractile function, at the mitral annulus, the peak systolic velocity of the S wave is mildly reduced. Normally, this S velocity should be at least 7.5 centimeters per second. This is the lower limit of normal. But in this case, it is 6.7 centimeters per second. It has been found that in patients with ventricular hypertrophy and generally in patients with a moderate or severe impairment of diastolic function, but with a visually normal contractile function and a normal ejection fraction, usually more sensitive indices of systolic function, such as tissue Doppler systolic annular velocity, peak systolic strain and strain rate, show that there is also a subclinical impairment of systolic function. Now let's get back to our patient. Our conclusion is that this is a hypertensive patient with target organ damage. To be more specific, she has an abnormal electrocardiogram indicative of left ventricular hypertrophy and an echocardiogram showing features of hypertensive cardiac disease such as mild left ventricular hypertrophy, mild to moderate diastolic dysfunction, and left atrial enlargement. So her blood pressure should be controlled relatively quickly. According to current guidelines, the goal of treatment for all hypertensive patients, even in high-risk patients with diabetes or chronic kidney disease or indications of target organ damage, is systolic blood pressure below 140 and diastolic blood pressure below 90, except from very elderly patients, 80 years or older, where the goal is to slowly achieve systolic blood pressure below 150. This patient was controlled to a blood pressure of 125 to 75 with an increase of the dosage of irbesartan from 150 to 300 milligrams every morning, and the addition of the calcium channel blocker lercanidipine, 1.5 tablet of 10 milligrams every evening, plus the usual dietary measures of reducing salt intake and increasing fruit and vegetables in the diet. She was also advised to quit smoking and to start regular aerobic physical activity of moderate intensity. She was also given a statin to achieve a target LDL cholesterol below 100 milligrams per deciliter. This target of LDL cholesterol was chosen because the severe hypertension, the smoking history, and the abnormal ECG and echocardiographic findings can be considered as indications of increased cardiovascular risk. She was also scheduled for a carotid ultrasound scan, which can provide an indication about the progress of atherosclerosis in her arterial system. A myocardial perfusion scintigraphy scan can also be considered in this case because of the abnormal ECG. To screen for coronary artery disease, one of the indications of a nuclear scan, a SPECT scan, is to establish or exclude the diagnosis of coronary artery disease in cases where the history or the ECG raises a suspicion of coronary artery disease, or as a screening test of high-risk subjects. Another option could be an ECG exercise test, but the presence of left ventricular hypertrophy and baseline ECG abnormalities can limit its diagnostic accuracy. For more information about the various patterns of abnormal diastolic function, that is grade 1, grade 2, grade 3 and grade 4 diastolic dysfunction, and their recognition, please visit my site in the chapter on hypertension. Thanks for watching this video.